Hello, I'm Shannon Eberhardt, the creator and producer of this video. What you're about to see are reenactments of true stories which represent common experiences of hundreds of tradespeople I interviewed while researching this project. Most of the performers that you will see are not actors, but are real apprentices and journey-level workers who are working in their respective trades. Even though the performers may identify with the characters they portray, the actors are performing a screenplay which is based on a compilation of actual events.
My name's Nick. I went through an apprenticeship as a bricklayer, got my journeyman's card, and then went to work in the trade. I found out I wasn't qualified or competent, and I could not work steady and hold a job. So I had to go into something else, find out what else I could do. I went into another field, and that field happened to be film documentaries. With this film, I want to return back to where my first career began to find out what happened, what went wrong. Was it me? Was it the system? Was it the people I worked with? There had to have been a problem. What was it? I made it through the apprenticeship program, and I used to laugh at the ones that didn't. Later, I wondered if they knew something I didn't. I thought I knew it all. I thought I had all the answers for the trade. My research shows that apprenticeship programs have been plagued with a high rate of dropout, especially among women and people of color. But even the percentage of white males dropping out of apprenticeship programs today is a lot higher than it was when I was an apprentice. This film we'll deal with situations that you will encounter as an apprentice. We will be talking with apprentices and journey level mentors who will be discussing what it takes to survive in the apprenticeship program and why so many people don't. I want to thank you all for coming here tonight. Glad to see you're all here on time. Why don't we start off by introducing ourselves. John, why don't we start off with you?
My name is John. I'm a 52-year-old electrician. I've been in the trades for 20 years.
I'm Marlene. I'm a carpenter apprentice.
Hi, I'm Tony. I'm a journey-level line worker. I've been a journey worker for 15 years.
I'm Alex. I've been an electrician for 17 years.
I'm Caitlin. I'm an apprentice electrician.
I'm Lisa. I'm a first-year phone company apprentice.
I'm Michael, second-year apprentice electrician.
I've asked you here to help me clarify a tension that I've noticed that exists between journey-level workers and apprentices. Where do you draw the line between the do-it-this-way, because this is the way it works mentality of the journey-level worker, as opposed to the apprentice who wants to try new ways of doing old things?
See, I'm not the only one who feels the tension.
Caitlin, quit whining. Learning how to get along have to be priorities for all apprentices.
Or at least be more selective, Caitlin, as to who you whine to.
John, you know as well as I do that whining isn't going to get Caitlin anywhere. Caitlin has got to go along and get along to be successful.
Yes, but we have a lot to contribute. We are a part of the crew now.
You are not part of the crew until we know that you will fit in and trust you to follow orders. We need you to do just what you're told and leave us to do our job.
Last week, I walked onto my job and asked what tools I needed to buy. The journeyman said, "Don't bother, you're not going to be here long enough to need tools. What are you doing here anyway? All you're doing is taking some man's job. All you are is a short-timer. I don't know why we bothered with your type. What am I supposed to do with that?"
He's probably worried you'll end up replacing him because the company only pays you half his salary. Just ignore that stuff.
I don't agree, Alex. Times have changed since you and I started out. Back then, we were the outsiders,
and going along and getting along was our only option. It used to be that an apprentice would either make it or not, depending on how well they put up or shut up, and no matter how bad it got. But I also rocked the boat quite a bit back then, and I hope that my rocking the boat helped to change things somewhat. I'm not so quiet anymore, and when I see things aren't right, I like to think that I've made a difference so these young folks don't have to go through what we did.
I take a stand when I need to. No one walks all over me and gets away with it. But mostly, I find ways to just get along.
We've paid our dues, and we've paved the way for the young folks. Now, if these young folks don't want to put up with what we did, and they have that right, then I have to support them.
That must be why some of the apprentices complain that if they have a different idea, want to try something different, or have a difference of opinion, they're immediately suspect.
Caitlin, what are you doing?
I'm going to put the pump in here and pump it out while we're doing our job.
No, I need you to be available to help me if I need it.
Well, I can pump this out and still stand by for you.
Caitlin, what part of no don't you understand? Or do you just have trouble following orders? Either you're trying to drive me crazy or you're just plain stupid.
I'm neither.
It must be then that women just have an uncontrollable need to clean.
I knew he was going to give me a bad time, and he did. But I contained the mess anyway, and by the end of our shift, cleaning it up was a breeze. It was cool.
Wow, Caitlin. Sounds like you came very close to committing a professional suicide.
Well, Lisa, there is a place for questions and innovation. I mean, how else are things going to improve? And to be honest, I will be the first to admit that we journey level don't always view progress with a smile.
But we're all missing the point. The apprentices first have to prove themselves. Then they can go about demanding change. We all had to pay our dues.
Fine, I'll pay my dues, even if they're a little higher than Caitlin's, because she's white or because Michael's a white man. Fine, don't act like I'm not even there when there's so much for me to learn. Don't forget, I have a brain and a life experience.
Hey, Arlene. I know I'm a white man, but I don't exactly fit a specific mold either. I have a college degree, I'm divorced, and raising my two kids alone. The trade has no tolerance for a single parent. I'm not your typical snooze-chewing, cussing, spitting, scratching he-man. I've got troubles fitting in, too.
Mike, I think the trouble is that the company's put so much heat on the journeyman to be more cost-effective, and the competition is so horrendous, and the journeymen are afraid of the 40-percenters. They just are worried about their jobs, so their heat runs downhill, and it's affecting you, and it's affecting apprentices and everybody else around. It's just not like it used to be. We don't have the time to sit down and go through the programs like we used to do.
It's not our fault. We were hired. All we want to do is learn the trade so we can make a contribution.
I agree with you, Lisa. I just don't agree on when and how you get to that point. Just have to look at it from a journalist's point of view.
Do they try to see our side?
We've all been there, Lisa. I know you're frustrated, but time and trust will change all that.
I've been in the military, and I grew up on a farm, so good hard work doesn't scare me. I've even worked with people who don't want me around. Forget it. I just want to do my job so I can support my sister and her kids.
Lisa, with your military background and coming off the farm, you're already prepared for the trades. You know what hard work is. With this teamwork attitude, if you just keep at it, it'll pay off for you.
You know, I can handle all that, and I grew up in the city. I just can't handle the sexist stuff. I want to be part of the team, but half the time they won't let me.
Caitlin, you're whining again. Get over it.
Well, how long before an apprentice has paid their dues?
Yeah, that's ready to turn out, I guess. Long time.
4 to 5 years for men, all your life if you're a woman.
What? All your life? No way.
Yes, Caitlin, all your life. Whenever you go on a new job site, you have to prove yourself all over again. I'm 45 years old, and they still treat me like an apprentice sometimes. Even when they know I'm a journey-level electrician, they're suspicious of whether I can actually do the work or not. If you're a woman, the spotlight is always on you. Don't expect to be able to do an average job and get away with it. You've got to do better and try harder.
Oh, man, that's bull. After 17 years of the journey level, you still have to prove yourself? No way. I won't do it. You shouldn't either.
Caitlin, do you know that after 20 years, they still ask me to sleep up? I guess it's because certain people look more natural doing certain jobs.
I can't believe we have issues like this, but we still do. I do what I can to change it. Some people never change.
We've been building the buildings the same way for years. Change how we do things will throw the entire system into a tailspin. And then where would we be? Nowhere. That's where. We do things the way we do them for a reason, and you're just going to have to go along. The fact that you're smaller, that's not my problem. Figure it out. But don't ask me to make your life easier, because it's not my job to make your life easier. You asked to be here. I didn't ask for all the extra work that you're going to make for me by demanding special treatment just because of your size, your sex, or your race. I figure only a dyke would want to do this kind of job.
What a jerk.
The military taught me about this kind of behavior, so it's nothing new to me. My problem as an apprentice is they give me a job and then they ignore me. I just want to be on the team, but sometimes they swear, they just pretend I'm not even there.
I know that one, Lisa.
I work with guys like that, but I only put up with so much and then one of us has got to go. I actually have other experiences too. On the other hand, with my training coordinator, he comes around and makes sure I'm getting the training I need, and he asks me about my life and helps me out with stuff.
Lisa, it's because the culture is changing and in trying to stay the same at the same time. It's absolutely crazy sometimes.
Yeah. Assimilation used to be the price of admission to the trades, especially for non-traditional workers like you and me, Lisa. It used to be easier back then. Everyone knew the rules. You new apprentices demand more visibility, and I'm concerned that you're going to fail because you want so much.
Somehow I get the impression this discussion could go on all night, but I think we need to end it here now. Thank you. Apprentices need to know how to assimilate, how to get along, and how to get their point across. They also need to know when they must go along with the system and when they can also act on their own behalf. I think it has to be taken on a case-by-case basis, and each individual has to develop their own style and technique.
I think we need to set up anything special other than the fact that we do real work situations.
Okay.
You know, just doing real work things helps make those things come better.
Good. I'm kind of curious how they really feel after being on a job for a couple of weeks. And I just seem to, you know, sit here for a few minutes and observe them, see, you know, see what they're really talking about, get some honest opinions. I'm kind of curious if they're going to be honest with us with a camera stuck in their face. What you're talking about, being in a real job situation, I think eliminates that.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that I've always known and just working with people in the trades a lot is that they're real honest.
Yeah.
I'm not getting an education. I feel like I'm in boot camp again. You know, I've got a college degree. I've been a teacher. I want to get past this hazing and teasing thing. I've paid my dues. I'm no wimp, but I really don't think yelling is the best way to learn anything.
Can I jump in here?
Sure.
I know what you're saying about the paying the dues.
Hey, Arlene, can you get the wire stretchers? I think Jones had them last.
Okay. Jones.
Dave just walked off with it, Arlene.
I think I saw it over by the sawhorse. What a stupid boot.
Hey, what does a wire stretcher look like?
You don't know? Ask Manuel. He knows what one looks like.
Manuel?
Oh, wire stretcher.
Manuel, can you tell me what a wire stretcher looks like?
Ask the foreman, I'm busy.
I've
been time to track down the wire stretcher.
The what?
The wire stretcher. I've been looking for it for a whole hour.
Very funny, boys. Arlene, just get back to work.
Oh. I can't believe I've been around for an hour looking for a wire stretcher.
I know. Yeah, but some journey level are serious when they do that stuff to you. They're not just joking.
Well, once I asked a journey level why there weren't more women apprentices on the job, and she said they just got tired of dealing with the underlying stuff like not wanting you here. The supervisors will put the guys with journey level and you'll get stuck with the laborers. You won't learn anything. You'll be digging holes or cleaning up some man's mess as a journey level because they can't see you any other way. But I want to come out of this program feeling like I know what I'm doing. How can I when I'm not even sure they know what they're doing? One day they have me dig a ditch, the next day I fill it in. What's that about? The work is hard, grueling, and a total waste of time. They say they're looking out for the bottom line, so why have me waste my time doing non-work? I don't get it.
But if it's your job, you gotta do it. It beats collecting a welfare check that doesn't cover expenses or fetching coffee for some guy who thinks he's real important.
Well, yeah, and that's just it. You know, what was the deal? When I dug that ditch, I did a really good job on that and thought that I would be rewarded with laying conduit the next day, but no, instead, I ended up filling the ditch in again, and then they had me move some conduit from one place to another, which was cool, except for that the next day, I ended up moving it back to the same spot. I never see the guys doing that stuff. The male apprentices are all up in the rafters learning their trade. I swear, I think that they think that I don't know what I'm doing, so they put me on light duty.
Sounds more like non-duty.
That's for sure. They only treat me like that because I'm a woman.
Well, women don't need special treatment. Think women need special treatment?
No.
All I want out of this is to get my journey level card, you know. No. That's all I want. And I want equality, you know. But I don't know if I'm going to get that.
You may not need special treatment, but sometimes parents do. You know, for me, you know, when I leave in the morning, my kids are asleep. When I get home, my kids are asleep. You know, I go to school, well, we're right here now, Monday and Wednesday night, and then I study on Tuesday and Thursday like everybody else. I hardly get to see my kids. If it wasn't for my mother, I couldn't afford daycare. You know, she takes care of them during the day, and, you know, I just couldn't afford it. With what I make at 65% of scale, I'd make more on welfare. If I had to pay for daycare. So, you know, I know other parents that are in other industries and they get personal time off to do things with their kids and take care of their kids. You know, sometimes I just don't think the trade is in step with reality.
Sometimes you have to make sacrifices.
Oh, yeah. Big time.
Well, my husband's real helpful with my kids. Otherwise, I wouldn't get to work on time.
That's why I don't have any kids. Not to mention how it would inhibit my social life.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. The other morning I got up and, you know, one of my kids was sick all night long. And so then he wanted me to hold him in the morning. And so I was 15 minutes late for work. And, boy, when I got in, the foreman just tore me. He can't believe how he treated me. It was crazy.
Hey, Mr. Mom finally makes an appearance.
Sorry I was late, but one of the kids was sick this morning.
I was going to put you to work with Roberts on the control panel. But since we don't know when you're going to get here, yeah. I had to give the job to somebody else. Why don't you get your butt in the back and start sorting cards?
You made me feel like a bad kid. The next time I have to get to work and my son wants me to hold him, what am I supposed to do? Sorry, son, Daddy's got to go to work.
I know what you mean, being late. It means that you can't handle your life or you can't be trusted. The last time I was late, everyone treated me as if I'd totally screwed up. It took me forever. I'm still trying to prove myself. But actually, you know, I want to be a kind of worker that people can count on to do the job. No, being late is the worst.
Yeah, it is.
Well, I hate not being there for my kids. I've been working a lot of overtime lately. I miss my kids' softball game, you know, that's really bad. But that's the way it is when you want to work overtime, you know. But if I don't show these bosses I mean business, they might not call me out on the next job, and I could be the first one laid off.
Mm-hmm. I know what you mean about overtime.
I'd been sorting hardware all day. It wasn't so bad. I got to know about all the different parts. I could tell the used and substandard from the good ones after a while. I even gave them special names. Never mind. But at 4 o'clock sharp, I heard something.
Don't look at me like that. Part of your job is to put this stuff away. It looks like you're going to be here a while, rookie.
That is totally demeaning.
Call it demeaning if you like. I call it overtime. That means money.
Yeah, but money, even with the overtime, I still ended up spending more than I earned because I had to leave my sister's kids at the daycare for another hour.
Well, speaking of money, time is money. You better get going. Don't want to be late, do we, Michael?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Well, good luck on that task.
Yeah, you too.
Yeah, great.
Not much has changed since I was an apprentice. The complaints are still the same. But I think industry does need to change. The needs of the workforce are changing, and I think industry needs to adapt to meet those needs. The apprentice, however, has to understand that they need to prove themselves to be serious. They need to be on time. They need to show that they are committed to learning their trades. A journey-level worker is not going to invest a lot of time, effort, or energy and emotion in an apprentice until the apprentice shows that they're there for the career, not just the job. The apprentice needs to show that they're there for the long haul, the benefits, everything that goes along with the journey-level status. And until they show that, the journey-level worker is not going to invest a lot of time.
You guys, mind if I sit in and listen?
Not at all, John. We were just talking about some of the key issues that I've come across by dealing with apprentices and talking with apprentices lately. I want you to talk about, you know, and address some of those issues. They're concerned about and they're surprised by the high level of accommodation and sacrifice they have to make as apprentices. You know, in order to fit into our industry, there's a lot of accommodation that they have to go through. Their personal lives. They worry about what it's doing to their personal lives, you know, that they and that they can adjust to it and survive in it. The child care issue is a big one. You know, what do I do with my kids? Johnny's got a cold. What do I do? They're concerned about their expenses, bills. You've got 12 months bills, but you've only got maybe 9-10 months income. What do you do? How do you accommodate and adjust to those issues? Seasonal work is a problem. Still others wonder if they can work all day and then go to school at night for years. Yeah. Apprenticeship is years. And, you know, can they do it? And there's a lot of issues. Can you address those for me?
I don't think people know what they're getting into. When I was in Vietnam, I thought I knew what bad was. But as an apprentice, when I get home, I felt like I was beaten with a stick. It seemed like all I did was go to work, go to class, and sleep. I was working overtime, and sometimes it was 7 days a week. At least in Vietnam, when I was on patrol, we had drinking water. And if I had to take a leak, I could take it anywhere in the bush. On the job site, usually the water's all the way on the other side. And if you go to get a drink, you're usually the first one to get laid off. When I did get laid off, I was really in debt. I had to keep my phone hooked up so I could go to the hall or call the hall and find out what the job situation was. I was paying my union dues. I still had to pay my tool payments. Unemployment was so humiliating for me. I never thought anything like this would ever happen to me. Some of my buddies and stuff, we'd get together and we'd drink beer, and I really believed that it wouldn't have taken much for me to become an alcoholic. I was so depressed. When I did go back to work, I had to buy foul weather gear, and I tried to cut corners, and I bought cheap stuff, and it turned out to be junk, and it just fell apart. I was running around on bald tires because I didn't have any money, and I finally ended up getting a traffic ticket for that, so I had to pay the traffic ticket, and I ended up buying new tires too, so it was really bad. I just didn't know what to do after a while, so I started eating nothing but junk food, the cheapest stuff I could find, and by the end of the shift, I'd be so weak I could hardly move. I'd get sick more often, I'd catch more colds and stuff like this. It was just endless. I didn't think it was ever going to end. I was just an accident waiting to happen.
Geez, you guys, my biggest worry is getting home after socializing and partying all night so I can be at my best the next day. Compared to everybody else, I've got it easy. I know it's true. You should have heard everybody on the phone last night at break.
What is it? Oh, no. No, I can't. What do you mean? The baby's here sick again? But I can't. I already said I was going to work, and I have to work tomorrow because then I won't be able to get the assignment next month if I don't show up. I said I was going to be there. It's overtime. We need it, you know? Yeah, I know you need the job, but can't you just reschedule it or something? You have to... Well, you know, I can't get out of the work, so, I mean, I can't do it. If I miss this day, it could be the end of the job. It's more important that I keep this job. No, that's not true. I'm always there. You have to watch the kids because I can't do it. Okay, we'll talk about it when I get home.
Sweetheart, how you doing? Yeah? I'll be home a little bit later. I'm still at school. No, I'm not going to miss the concert. I'm going to be there in time for this one. I'm just going to be a little bit late. I'm going to try and get out of class a little early. No. No, tonight's a... No, no, I'm not going to miss it. Tonight's a school night, and I just got to get out of class a little bit early, and I'll just be there a little bit late. Are you all ready? Grandma got you all ready? Good, good. Yeah, I'm sorry, sweetie, but I'll be there in a little while. Can I talk to your grandma? Can I talk to your grandma, please? No, she's there, sweetheart. Come on, let me talk to grandma. Would you go get your grandma, please? Hi, Mom, how you doing? I'll be home in a little while, and I'll help you get him ready if you haven't left. I won't be late. I'll try and be there on time, but I may be a little bit late for the concert. So if I'm not there in a little, by 7 o'clock, go ahead and take off without me, and then I'll just meet you at the school. She had a fever last night, so she's still pretty sick. Yeah, I think she's got that infection back again. So. Yeah, I'll take her to the doctor's Friday. Well, I know, but right now at the doctor's office, I owe him some money, so I gotta give him the copay when I get there, and payday's Friday, so. No, I appreciate the offer, but I know I already owe you some money. Mom, I'm 33 years old. Come on, I'd just rather wait till Friday. Okay, we can talk about it later, okay?
You know, honey, I hate to tell you this, but I got laid off again today. That's the bad part about this kind of work. I mean, the work's good, money's good when we're working, but it's the seasonal part, that's what's getting to me. And it's really getting me depressed, it's getting me down, and that's why I really want to take this chance. I know we can make this work. I really believe it'll work good. So now's a good chance. The government's got some programs on for minorities to get started in their own small businesses. I know a couple of guys that have started out real small and have done good. It's a risk and it's a gamble. I don't either, honey. Not right now. I see this back and forth, work a while, off a while, it's starting to take its toll on me. And I really believe now is a prime time to get into this trade. I believe now is the time to do this. It's a green light out there right now for small business. Competition is pretty small right now. I promise you, we won't. I'm not going to do that to you. There's no way I'd do that to you. And, all right, actually, honey, I got a couple other people here that wants to use the phone. And if I got my back turned to them, they want me to hear what I'm talking about. Think about it. You know, be thinking about it. We'll talk about it more when I get home. Okay. Honey, I promise you we won't lose the house. We're not going to lose the house. I'm not going to do that to you. Okay, now be thinking about it when we get home tonight. We'll finish talking about it. Okay? All right, sweetheart. Talk to you later. Love you. Bye-bye.
Yeah, can I have the appointment desk, please? Yeah, this is Alex Johnson. I need to get an appointment sometime this week, preferably to go over. No, it's really important. I got to see the doctor. He told me I could get in before the end of the week, and it's really important. I've been waiting since. Well, he did. He told me I could come in and get this taken care of. I'm having a really hard time here, and I need to see him. Well, I got to have one after 4 o'clock, and you got Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, whatever, but I got to get one. I'll even come in Saturday and see him. What do you mean you don't work on Saturday? A lot of people got to have, Saturday appointments because they can't get off work. I mean, I can't take any more time off work because of this stuff. I've missed enough time. Well, I can't take time off work, and I've got to see the doctor. This is just really getting me down, and it's starting to affect my work performance, and I just can't miss any time to take off work, and I can't keep working feeling like this either. I've got to see the doctor and see him find out about those tests. I don't want to be referred to any other doctor. I've been seeing this doctor, and I think we're getting close to finding out what's going on with me here, and it's going to be a question of whether I can even continue. Being doing this work. I just can't keep working and not knowing what's going on without getting some help from the doctor. And I've got to see. I can't take time off work. I've already told you that. I don't have any more time to take off. No, I can't take time off work. And if I don't find out what's wrong with me, I'm not going to be able to go to work. Well, I guess I'll just have to call back.
Right.
Break's over.
Oh. I don't have any quarters. Anybody got a quarter?
Alex, why not just take the time off? Health concerns seem like a legitimate reason to be absent from work.
Caitlin had no right to listen to our personal phone calls.
I know, but
the company is always looking for reasons to give women and people of color a bad time about taking time off for work, child care, for health reasons, for any reason. There is no reasonable excuse for women and people of color to take time off from work. We are held to a higher standard.
I know, but
Nick, can I break in here? Let me tell you, early on in my career, I had a family crisis and had to take some time off to get things straightened out. And when I returned to the hall, I had the damnedest time getting work. I had the stereotypes of my race to overcome, plus the perception I couldn't be dependent on to show up every day. And it took me years to rebuild my reputation again. And having a reputation of dependability is worth tens of thousands of dollars because it means work. Being a non-traditional worker, both Alex and I had to overcome these stereotypes. Isn't that right, Alex?
Yeah, I gotta go.
Wait a minute, I'm going to go with you. I'll go out with you.
But wait, this is a relentless industry, and if you're not consistently dependable, forget it. Apprentices need to learn how to manage their personal lives. All apprentices need backup systems, friends, family, someone who will be there for them physically, emotionally, mentally. It's not easy, I can tell you, but it's got to be done.
Let me see if I'm saying anything that you don't agree with. In construction work, it's really hard on the body. A lot of young people aren't willing to pay the price anymore and sacrifice that it takes. They've got to be willing to work outside in bad weather, hard weather, inclement weather, long hours, nights, weekends, everything else. A lot of times on the job, you're taxing yourself to the ultimate limit, yeah. Both physically and mentally. And it is a tough price to pay, and a lot of people aren't willing to do it. I think as an apprentice, you've got to develop some real, you know, some real strong intestinal fortitude and a lot of guts, because it takes a lot of both to survive in the job.
Sounds about right, Nick. Hey, Caitlin, what's with those knee pads? You wear those to bed, too?
Depends on who I'm sleeping with.
Oh, really? What's with the knee pads?
Oh, I use them for work. I even use these for soccer. I did such a number on my knees during work, you know, crawling around and stuff, that it walking hurt. So now I use these. Some people think I'm a wimp, but I don't care. I do whatever it takes to keep my body in shape.
Yeah, I didn't wear gloves at first like they suggested in the class. None of the journeyman level on the job were wearing gloves, so I didn't either. And my hands got all cut and bruised and beat up. I was miserable. So I finally decided to start wearing gloves. And I'm now the only one on the crew that wears gloves. But
wow.
At least I go home at night and my hands aren't bleeding and I don't have Band-Aids all over them. I feel pretty good.
What's this about? You work all day on the job to come down here and work all night. Don't you get enough digging at work all day, Michael?
I know. Digging holes sucks.
Yeah, I hate it.
Of all the grunt work, it's got to be the worst.
Definitely. Digging a trench sounds simple, but it's strenuous, and it can really be frustrating. Full of hidden challenges like soft or muddy soil that sloughs back in on you, or when a large boulder is in your way. I know I need to strengthen my whole body to protect my back.
God, I know what you mean. I've been working on my hands and my forearms. I've been squeezing these balls everywhere, in my house, in my car, at work, at lunchtime. My roommates have been laughing at me big time. Huh. But I'm finding I've been having a hard time holding forearm and cutting it with one hand. It's,
yeah.
You know, pretty hard to do. But I'm just, you know, I got to strengthen them up so that I can stay with the program.
I bet you they're easier on you because you're a woman. You probably don't even have to dig the hole. Not true, huh?
Yeah, right, Nick. The most important thing for all of us to remember is to be physically fit and ergonomically correct. Last week when I was cleaning insulators, I was up and down that ladder, reaching out, reaching down, moving heavy insulators from a ladder. My back was tired, my shoulders were sore. There's no way for anyone to strengthen themselves for those types of jobs. So I guess it's also important to know how to recover from strain and fatigue.
Yeah, fatigue's a real problem. I remember this one time we'd worked all day on the job and a call came in that they had some problems at Whidbey Island Naval Air Station and they wanted some people to go out there and fix a high voltage feeder that had blown up. So the journey level asked me if I wanted to help them, and it sounded like good experience, so
yeah.
I was really excited about it. So we took off and headed out there, and it was the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, and it was raining cats and dogs, and traffic was miserable, and we didn't get out there till 10 o'clock at night. And they met us at the gate and took us in, and we opened up the vault, and they wanted us to jump right in it and start splicing, so we climbed down there and it was full of water, so we had to drop a pump in and we couldn't get it all pumped out and had to throw some boards in there to stand on, and kept raining, the water was pouring in through all the conduits. It was really miserable.
Wow.
And we just started splicing, and it was really important to them because it was the feeder for the tarmac and they couldn't start any of the jets without it, so we had to get it going. And we just worked right through it till we got it done. It was a really tough job. I remember I was tired, and we were trying to keep each other awake, so we'd come up with, you know, little challenges to keep ourselves going and you know, pass the time, make it go by a little faster and not really space out. So we got it done, got it online, and everything worked out, and it was a good, interesting job for me. I enjoyed it. Boy, the trades require a lot of physical endurance.
Yeah, not to mention the internal grit.
Yeah.
I get so tired sometimes I can hardly see straight. Takes a lot just to keep myself from walking right off the job.
You bet.
I create little games with myself sometimes, like if you can do just this one more thing, you can have an extra beer when you get home. Or the crew members will do little games, you know, competitive things, see who can get more done and stuff like that. And Lord knows I'm pretty competitive, so it's easy for me, keeps me motivated.
You bet. Yeah, I have to remember to pace myself at the beginning of the day, or I just won't have enough oomph to get the job done at the end.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that can get dangerous, can't it?
Well, that's why I have to pace myself, and that's why I'm here working out. Besides, there are other dangers out there on the job for me to worry about, like having the right stuff or the right tools to do the job.
Caitlin, I'm going to be over by the transformer. There's a wrench. Just start tearing this thing apart, and we got to be out of here by 4:15, so put a move on it.
Wait, Bob, I can't reach it.
What, are you not tall enough?
No, I need another ladder.
We don't have another ladder. Just get it done. We got to be out of here by 4:15.
You got an extra step there. Go ahead, move on up.
I can't stand on there. That's not safe. I don't want to fall.
Just get it done. I'll be over by the transformer.
Go ahead. You're not tall enough. Move up on the
It can be a disaster if you don't know when to ask for what you need to be safe. I need to do things differently because I'm smaller and I lack the upper body strength of most of the guys I work with. It can really piss the crew off. But I have found that when I get the tools I need to do the job, which is rarely that big a deal, it's even better for everybody. I don't need to do the butch thing unless I really have to or I feel like it at the time. There are times that a job can get done without forcing it, though, and I have to push a little harder than I'd like, but not that often. I don't want to wear this little body out before it's time.
I think we're going to have to get a preemie stretcher for this one, Bob. She's not tall enough.
You may be small, Caitlin, but I don't think I'd mess with you.
Good choice, Nick.
Hey, this accommodating thing, doesn't that get expensive and time-consuming?
Oh, I don't know about that. There was this one time when I was working with this guy that wasn't really all that much bigger than I am or stronger, and we were unloading steel conduit out of the back of a truck. And we didn't want to break our backs, so I found some slings and some rope, and we rigged up a pulley system, and it helped us unload the steel out of the truck. And even though everybody was laughing at us all day, the next day they were using the same thing, so.
Well, that makes sense. Why should you do something that might not be good for your body type just because it's always been done that way, if there's a better way to do it that's safer on your body?
Yeah, and they'll still respect you if they know that you're not trying to get out of work.
Mm-hmm.
One time I was supposed to drill through quarter-inch steel, like a 5/8-inch hole, and I know from experience that when you get to the end of it, sometimes the drill bit will grab the steel and, you know, twist your wrist around, and you can break your wrist. So I found myself a Whitney punch because it's a lot safer and rigged it up for the hole, and it was really easy, and it was a lot safer.
Nice job.
I don't know about you, but I'm headed for the showers.
Sounds good to me.
Watching these two work has worn me out. I can't believe how much physical endurance, intestinal fortitude, stamina, and safety consciousness it takes to make it in the construction industry.
Culture is reported to be one of the main reasons that apprentices are dropping out of the programs. The harassment, the hazing, the games, all the sexual innuendos and everything else that goes on. I guess what I want to know is what effect it's having on the apprentices. Is that the dominant reason they're dropping out? And find out why the ones that are surviving, you know, what made them stay in it. Michael, what effect has the trades culture had on you?
Well, about a month into the program, I almost dropped out. It was, you know, after a day of pranks and hazing and harassment, I went home and talked to my brother about it, and told him how I felt. He talked me into sticking it out, so I just been taking it one day at a time. You know, the atmosphere out there is bad. I don't like being subjected to some of the things that go on out there. I'm proving myself. I have a family and a mortgage and a college degree. I've paid my dues. I don't feel like I need to be treated in a demeaning way and called a grunt and made me do some of the things they asked me to do. I pulled my own weight out there, and I deserve to be treated with respect. I don't like the attitudes of some of the journey workers with all the sex talk and gutter language, bathroom behavior. It's tough. All the teasing and humiliation you get if you make one mistake or do something that's considered out of line. The sexist and racist jokes. It's all so offensive. I'm not even comfortable talking about it here.
Mike, if I was you, I'd be worried about talking about this too much. You could be looked at as a whiner.
We really want you to be frank. Maybe we can give you some help.
Mike, all of us here knows the culture needs to change. It can't continue going on this way and grow. That's because the workforce is looking different.
I believe the culture's never going to change. No company can police every jerk that's out there in the workplace. You have to develop a thick skin to make it in the construction trades. Otherwise, it wears you down. Michael, you need to make a decision whether you want to work in this kind of culture or not, because once you turn out and start making the big bucks, the pension, the health and welfare, you need to stay in it for your family and yourself for the long term.
Are you condoning their behavior out there? Bob, you got a second to help me out with this cable?
It's break time.
I know, but I've been tracing this cable out.
What you got here?
I'm tracing this cable out.
Is that a
cable? It goes right down there in that rat's nest. If you can just
HBO with that?
But I just need a little bit of help. It'll just take a second.
What are you working on? So you got yourself a cable?
They want me to trace this cable out, so I'm trying to identify.
How long have you been spending on this job?
About an hour and a half.
I thought we told you this was going to be like about a 20-minute job.
Well, it was all tangled up down there. It took me a while to get through it.
You know, it's
right
break
into
time.
Another
rat's
nest there. I understand.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to get this done before
well,
I take a
break. Well, it's
break
time. So how come you're still
well, I don't
want to
waste all the time I just spent on it. I'm almost there. If you could just help me at the other end.
Yeah, why don't you pull on this man's cable?
No, I think he wants you to pull on his cable.
I don't pull on
you
nobody's cable.
You want to pull cable. On your cable?
You're asking me to
hey,
pull
Bob,
on your
why
cable?
You pull
I mean,
cable?
It'll just take you
didn't
a
we
second.
Just tell you it was break time?
Can't you give me a hand?
You know, we've been taking the break same time every day. How many years, Bob?
This is ridiculous, yeah. This is ridiculous. A 20-minute
okay,
a 20-minute
you
job.
You want me to spend my time, my break
job.
Time, working on your cable. Cable that should have taken you 20 minutes.
Can I just borrow
you
your
cable? You know, I know.
If I can mark it, I can come back to it.
You know, we got a girl back here, I think,
take...
in training. Still in a training bra, actually. I think come out of here, probably knock this out in about 10 minutes. And you're taking an hour and a half on this job. And now you
well,
want me to take
all,
my
it
time.
It was all tangled up.
I'm going to waste my time.
It'll
on your
only
job.
Take you a second.
Yeah, this is.
Can I just borrow your face tape? Just let me use your tape there, and I'll mark
it. Oh, you want to use my tape?
Well, yeah.
What happened to your tape?
What's on my? It's with my tools back at the cable.
You don't have your tools.
I didn't think I'd need them though. I'm just tracing it.
No, the only time you don't need your tools is when you're going on break. You see me with the tool belt?
I got a sandwich. Jake,
can I just please borrow
your mark time. This. It's break time.
It's break time. You get in the hand. Why don't you just let it go? Okay. Don't worry about it, okay? It's going to have to be redone anyway.
You know, what's the big deal?
It's just a way to pay your dues. Journeymen test apprentices all the time. They make them sweep, they make them clean, they make them do every goofy job on the job site. But you got to have a sense of humor about it. But there is a line. And once they go over that line, teasing you and messing with you, you got to hold your ground. It's just the way it is. But if the line isn't crossed, you ought to go along with the journeyman. Why make a mess for yourself?
But you do have a right to be treated fairly, and you should be treated fairly. Sometimes you have to draw the line. And when you draw the line, you make that line then, and nobody gets you. That's where nobody crosses that line. Sometimes you just have to be savvy about where you're going to take a stand. And sometimes you just have to fight back.
Does it really happen all that often? Are there really that many cases or of abuse of apprentices, that, like what Michael suffers, that you can tell me about? Give me some examples.
Yeah, I knew this young female apprentice, and the foreman just tortured her. He gave her every screwy, degrading job he could think of. He pushed on her all the time. He said she couldn't work. He humiliated her. And it was some kind of a sadomasochistic relationship he seemed to want, because then he started asking her out to date. She had a little kid. She didn't have anywhere to go. And it just got to her to the point she finally washed out. She just couldn't take it.
Yeah, I got a story. When I was a second year apprentice, I came into the dry shack one day for lunch and opened up my lunch bucket, and here was a dead rat on top of my food. It was all I could do to keep from getting sick right there on the spot. I had to throw the food away, the lunch box away, and from then on out, I brought my lunch and ate in my car by myself.
It's terrible. Yeah, I know what you're saying. Yeah, I've Through the years I've been in the trade, I've seen quite a bit of this hazing and some of the jokes, practical jokes played on the apprentice and so forth. And it's one that tends to stand out with me. It's in our situation we have, when a line worker's up there, he's in what we call a bucket truck. He's up working on the pole and so forth. Well, in order to get the material up and down to the journey worker, we have what's called our grunt bags or whatever. You put your material in the bag, you put it on the handline, you pull it up to him, and if he's got stuff in there, he puts it in the bag and sends it back down to you. But this one particular journey worker had an apprentice working the handline for him one day, and I think he pulled one of those little, I call it a little crappy stunts or a little shitty deal he pulled. Because what he did, he could have easily come down in the bucket. What he did is he took one of these bags and hang on the side of his bucket, put it over in the bucket, pulled his pants out, and took a shit in the bag. And put it on the handline and sent it down to the apprentice and tell the apprentice to get rid of that. And I thought that was really rotten and nasty. Something the apprentice shouldn't have to go through.
That sounds pretty bad.
You really messed up this time, you fool. No one can help you now. You messed up big time. You could have killed me, asshole. Now, it's one thing. If you took this job so you could commit suicide, I mean, go ahead. I support you 100%. Do us all, do the world a favor. But my life is worth something. I'll be damned if I'll allow a pea-brained, inbred jerk like you to kill me. You shit for brains. You're supposed to be some kind of second-year apprentice, and you're acting like a damn preemie. You useless moron! I mean, where did you get your training from? Some little actress on a late-night infomercial? Because I sure as hell know no one around here could have possibly screwed you up like this damn retard that you're acting like. Or maybe it's just that you're plain old-fashioned, stupid, stupid, stupid. Do you have any idea how dangerous your irresponsibility is? This is no time for your dumb, immature, lollygagging, farting around. You know, maybe you're just not ready for a serious adult professional job. Why don't you go back to your mommy? Because maybe she'll put up with your shit, because I sure as hell won't. If you are attempting to prove what? If you are attempting to prove what a boot you are, what an idiot you are, what a grunt you are, what a measly little piss ant of a shit frame worm you are, well, let me tell you, you have succeeded in flying star spangled colors. You're larger than life, asshole!
Why would anybody want to come back after being treated like this? Why would people want to be in the trade if they had to put up with this?
There's always some jerks on every job, regardless of what you do. The jerks give the trades a bad name. But usually there's not that many jerks around the job.
All apprentices have to go through it. It's just part of the training. If they can't take it, they won't be able to survive the trades. As they say, adversity builds character and strengthens one's resolve to succeed.
Well, I guess I'd be lying if I said times haven't changed. They have changed some. Nothing like it should have, though, because there's still lots of jerks around. You're always going to find one in every crowd. You let one jerk or find some woman, pick her out, and give her a hard time, and everybody just stand by and watch and just won't do a thing. It's just not right, and things need to change.
This is what I get from what all of you have been talking about. The trades culture is a distinctly unique experience that a lot of apprentices are not prepared for. Maybe that was part of my problem. I just didn't fit in. Not really. In light of the boot camp activity, the hazing, the testing, does harassment, sexual, ethnic, or otherwise, whatever, does it really exist?
You bet it does. I'm seeing more and more harassment today toward women, and I'm equating it to what we used to go through, the African-American male used to go through years ago, when we were being harassed and victimized. Today it's happening to women. I'm seeing it every day. They're constantly being harassed, they're constantly being the butt of different pranks, jokes, what have you. I'm seeing a lot of it more and more. And what's happening, I'm seeing a lot of the women are being scrutinized, they're being stereotyped. And that was the same thing that was happening to us back in the late 60s when I was a trailblazer. when I tried to open the doors. Well, now some of the women are being trailblazing. They're opening the doors for other women, and the same thing is happening to them, and I'm seeing it more and more every day. It hasn't changed, and it hasn't stopped, and the way I see it, we've all got a long ways to go.
I don't sweat the small stuff. Sometimes these guys act worse than 13-year-olds. But what the hey? Let them draw their huge genitalia and tell their dirty jokes, as long as they don't touch me. But if they touch me, I decked a guy once by kneeing him in the groin for the oldest prank in the book. He asked me how I was feeling. I said, fine, thanks. He came right over and squeezed my breast and said, yep, you feel fine. But there's a double standard out there. As a woman, you have to tolerate swearing and dirty jokes, but God forbid if you do it yourself.
So you're saying harassment does exist, but you've got to learn how to handle it.
You only have to know how to handle it to a point and go to your supervisor.
Yeah, John. I went to my mentor when my nickname became quoted me.
It's only a nickname. It's no big deal. It could be worse. Believe me. When it comes right down to it, I haven't seen any sexual harassment as long as I've been on the job. Well, maybe I used to see it, but if one of my apprentices tells you that she's been a victim of sexual harassment, that's flat bull. Sexual harassment is something jerks do. And there are a few out there, but not the majority. For the most part, the journeyman is a compassionate, respectful person. And for anyone to say that every woman who walks on the job is going to be harassed, ridiculed, and run down is flat bull. It pisses me off that these groups enter the trades and start running the good men down out there. I know what goes on out there, and sexual harassment is not the norm.
How many women on your work are there on your work site?
One, two.
How many people are there total?
50, 60, it depends.
And how many of them are jerks that harass women?
Oh, how should I know?
Oh, come on. 1, 10, 30?
5, 6 tops.
Oh, 10%. What's the likelihood that that 10% of the workforce could find the one woman? I'm here to tell you that 100% of women get harassed. I'm not saying that all men are harassers. But all women have to put up with being bothered on the job about their gender. The fact that most men doesn't harass doesn't minimize any woman's experience.
That's right.
If you are not one of the 10%, then this is not about you. You don't have to be so damn defensive. Listen and do what you can to make the workplace free of harassment for all of us.
I'm impressed, Alex.
Don't be.
I'm not ashamed to say I had to go to my supervisor.
What happened?
Hey, little darling, you want to see if you can hand me some of those nails there? Hey, you think you can hand me some of those nails?
Sure.
Okay, take her slow there, little darling. Hey, you might want to unbutton those top two buttons.
My buttons?
I could use the boost.
Boost this grunt sack up there.
No. Too bad.
Oops. Watch where you're dropping them nails, man.
I'm sorry, little darling.
Dangerous.
Here. Jeez. Hey, you want me to help you with those nails there? You want me to help you? No? Well, then why don't you just get them all yourself, okay?
Well, why don't you come down
and why don't
and
you hand those to me pronto if you think you can get your lazy ass moving?
Lazy
Speaking
ass.
Which.
I can't believe you're saying
hey,
this.
Hey, you be sure and bend over so as I can see now. Nothing finer than a black ass, I always say.
You little bastard.
Well, then hurry up and hand me those damn nails already, you bitch.
Bitch? Calling a bitch.
Now, see what you made me do.
You better watch them nails.
Now, I don't know why the hell he stuck me with you. At least while she's in here driving me nuts, you can't be out there making any more than brown babies. There's just too damn many of them. They screw like bunnies, and we have to pay for it. Hey, little darling, I tell
you. Don't call me little darling.
Hey, why don't you just come home with me for one night? I'll show you some real work.
In your dreams.
No, well, I know it's hard for you people to learn new things and all, but I bet if you'd like it if you tried.
You're a fine piece of work, you jerk.
I can't believe he didn't rip his tongue out.
Here we go into the next century and there's still jerks around like that. It pisses me off.
I hear what happened to you. I've been there myself. I guess my anger's all used up. I just can't feel anything.
I'm sorry, Arlene.
Why are you apologizing? It's not your fault.
You're right. I know it. But I'm sorry anyway. I'm just sorry you had to go through that. It's getting treated like a little job just makes it hard all the way around. I've had white men that want to do me favors and help me get jobs or help me get things, but they would always tell me in private that they knew I was getting a raw deal or knew things weren't going right or weren't going as it should be. But the problem was they would tell me in private as opposed to coming out forward and helping me out. And that's just like not saying anything at all.
It's not what they say. It's how it affects you and me.
You got a good point, Alex. One day I was reading one of those women magazines in the dentist's office. The article was about battered women syndrome. Now, my husband would never, I mean, never do anything like that. But I was reading, I got heart palpitations because I thought some of the symptoms was me. I was questioning whether I could be good at things. I blame myself for being yelled at because I make mistakes too.
Sounds like something I should read, but then I don't read anything anymore either.
The effects of harassment and isolation are awful.
Harassment's nothing to joke about. It's illegal. Trying to determine when to walk away, when to say something, there's no simple answer. But what if you're not involved with it, either as a participant or a victim? What do you do? Do you have a role in stopping it? I'd like to thank all the journey level workers and apprentices for participating in this video and putting this together. This has been our contribution to the apprentices of the future, and hopefully this will give you some information so that if you're confronted with one of these situations, you'll have some tools to work with and be better prepared in dealing with it. You won't be the first to have been confronted with this type of situation, so you really shouldn't feel singled out when this comes up. I'd like to thank all you people for participating in this, and I'd like some input from you. You know, give me some feedback. How has this helped you? Maybe there's some more information you can give us, some tips, any information like that. Again, thank you very much for your participation.
Well, for me, it's made me more aware of what others are going through out there, and it's made me realize that I'm not the only one that has the feeling that the culture is a little too rough and that changes need to be made. Not that it hasn't made some changes. After talking with some of the older journey levels, I've come to realize that the trades have gone a long way as far as change, but there's still a lot of change that needs to be done. And I've decided at this point that I want to be a part of that, so I'm going to stick with the trade and work through it and be a part of the change.
Well, for me, I never realized how differently I've been treated until I saw myself on film. I can't believe it. I'm shocked. And I'm very compelled right now to make sure that that changes.
Well, it was hard for me to be harassed on film. You know, I don't want people to think that it doesn't exist anymore because it really does. And one day they're going to get it right, but I'm going to make it.
Well, I've enjoyed doing this video, and I've learned a lot. I never actually realized how fortunate I am to be in the apprenticeship program that I am in, especially after hearing some of the stories from the other apprentices. I'm very glad I haven't had to experience such treatment as they have. I would say it's important to not only learn how to deal with the culture, but also just learn how to become a really good team member and to make a contribution to the work team.
I think the video has really helped us have a better understanding of each other's problems. For me, it was like a dim memory coming back. All the explanations of things that have happened to these individuals, I really didn't believe that it was this bad. 30 years ago, I believed that the perceived threat to the journeyman back then was a lot different. Most of the guys that came on the job site was related to somebody. It was Hank's son or Hank's nephew or something like that. So you knew you weren't going to lose your job, or you didn't have the perception that you were going to lose your job over this. So for the people that's in the programs now, I really believe it's a lot harder. The perceptions of a threat by a young person coming up the way is there in the older journeyman's mind. The perception of being pushed out of the workforce because of your age is in the journeyman's mind, which in turn, the journeyman has a lot more resentment towards the apprentices in certain cases. They don't understand. There's got to be a lot of change, a lot better understanding, and I think if we can get somewhere where we have, like in this group, I think we'll be fine.
Yeah, for me, I guess I can say I had a real good experience in making this video. I listened to the apprentices talk about their experience. It makes me think back when I first came through, and it was lots of... I guess we went through lots of changes and stuff. First, I'm missing Mike. I'm glad to say that you're here, that you're going to stick it out. You'll find it to be worthwhile in the long run. It's kind of sad to say that a lot of this stuff is still going on, but hopefully this video will show those that that get a chance to see it, what it was like for the old apprentices used to go through, what these apprentices are still going through now, and hopefully what it'll be like in the future. I'm hoping that this video will help those that get a chance to see it, see that what harassment is, or what it's about. That it's something that shouldn't be a part of the workplace. And harassment is something that we're not gonna happen. It should not and will not be a part of this workplace. And I hope that my part of this video makes a contribution into helping the people understand this, or help to achieve this understanding. I guess you can say I got a dream.
Where's Alex?
Believe it or not, she quit.
No. Why?
She claims medical problems. Who really knows?
She couldn't even come and say goodbye.
Well, hold on now. Wait a minute now. I know Alex. Alex says something's wrong. It's called burnout. I know Alex's been around as long as she's been around. I'm sure she got bone tired, got completely fed up with being the only woman or having to deal with being the only woman every day on the job. And I'm sure it chipped away with it. That kind of stuff just beats away at you. And it just apparently took its toll from her. She was one of the best. When Alex started out, she survived the only way they could in those days, and that was by adapting.
Yeah, I think Alex was quite a trailblazer. She put up with more than most. I knew it was eating at her, but I just didn't know what to do.
She sure made my job easier. I wouldn't have been able to do what she did.
I wonder what she'll do next.
She's a survivor. She'll be okay. But what I really hope is that things will change significantly enough so that we don't have to go through this or put up with this anymore. Anybody want to shoot some pool?